You can hang on to it. Just keep pulling really hard. Just hang on to it. Just let it go up. Thank you.
welcome on this Memorial Day weekend to worship here at Foothills. I'm Pastor Brad. I'm pleased to see so many of you here. So thank you for coming to be a part of what it is that we're doing. We're doing a refreshment coffee hour time right after the service. I invite you to join us right downstairs for that. Have some great conversations and some refreshments. So glad you're here. Looks like it's going to be a great weekend. We got the Memorial Day parade tomorrow. It's trucking out. Looks like about a mile and a half walk. So it's a good morning. So once someone picks me up at the end, that'll be good. We do have a funeral service here tomorrow at 2 p.m. for Beverly Lowenthal. Some of you have heard that news this week. She was with us a few short weeks ago for a celebration of Richard's. It's Bob Lowenthal's mother. So that service will take place here tomorrow at 2 p.m. Again, with a time of refreshments and conversation afterwards to kind of share your thoughts, your feelings, show your support to the Lowenthal family. So we invite you to that. This time next week, I plan on being in Florida. My wife and I are going to try to do that vacation thing again. We tried a few months ago. One flight got canceled, another flight got canceled, and we came back to work. So we're going to try this again. I'm going to see my three kids in Florida. If flights get canceled again, I'll be back to work on Monday. I'm glad you're here. We're jam-packed today. You can be my straight man, right? Straight person. So here's the line I want to say. What do you need an elephant for?
What do you need an elephant
for? So that's your line. What do you need an elephant for? I wish I had enough money to buy an elephant.
What do you need an elephant
for? I don't. I just wish I had the money. And so I looked, how much does an elephant cost? A baby elephant. $100,000. They work for peanuts here. $100,000. Boy, I wish I had enough money to buy an elephant. And I wish you did, that'd be about $500,000 right there. That's $2 million, it's $5 million. But we don't. We have what we have that God has given to us. And whether it be $100,000 or $100 or $10, we're called to be good stewards of that. Which means a portion of that doesn't belong to you, it belongs to the Lord. And so I found that if we're just faithful with those things, if we worship God with our hands open, that God will take those gifts offered to Him, use them, multiply them, bless them, and bring about His kingdom on earth. So we thank you for all the ways you give faithfully, cheerfully, willingly to this church, to the ministries. We're excited about the opportunities God's affording us. And let's just say a word of prayer before we take this morning's tithes and offerings. Lord God, we are thankful today for every good and perfect gift that comes from you, the Father of lights. God, we are a blessed people, so we ought to be most thankful people, most generous people. Thank you, Lord, for the gifts that are about to be received. Use them for your divine purpose, God. Multiply them, use them to bring people into saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Savior. This is a holy time. It's precious. It's a time of worship continuing. We ask all this in the beautiful name of Christ. Amen. created all things and called them good, yet there exists evil in the world. I read you a letter from our bishop a couple of weeks ago, and putting into words what happened this past week down in Uvalde, I struggled to word it better than our own bishop did, so I want to share those words with you, because to me, at least in my home, grief and sorrow entered in. And I don't think there's a home or a place that's not been affected by it. Man, the bad news, the things that are happening, and it's scary, and it's sad, and it's frustrating, and all those things. So from the desk of Bishop Mark Webb, he sent to us these words. Again, exclamation, again, we are faced with senseless violence, murder, and destruction of any sense of normalcy. African Americans should not have to fear being shot in the grocery store. Asian Americans should not have to fear being shot while at work. People should not have to worry about being shot while riding the subway, hanging out at a bistro, or going to church. Kids should not have to fear being gunned down at school. Once again, we cry out to God and lift up the families and victims of the Tuesday shooting at Robb Elementary School in Uvalde, Texas. We pray for those parents, grandparents, sisters, brothers, aunts, and uncles, where their precious loved ones, their children, violently taken away from them. We pray for the families of the teachers who were murdered. We offer healing prayers for those injured and in critical condition. We plead for God's presence to be known in a community that has been turned upside down. We pray for the family of the gunman. Our systems and our society must change. Laws must change. We must deal with racism. We must deal with gun violence. But even greater, we must deal with the disease of a culture that tolerates violence and hate too often, in too many forms. We must acknowledge and address a society that is becoming numb and a culture that is looking spiritually bankrupt. As those who follow Jesus Christ, we know what we have witnessed repeatedly in our society is not God's desire. We know there is a better way. The gospel of Jesus Christ proclaims a different way. These are spiritual matters. These are matters of evil and darkness. These are matters of the heart. And as a church of Jesus Christ, let us encourage and demand that those responsible in position work for policy change. But let us not stop there or place our hope in that work alone. As a church of Jesus Christ, our hope is in the living God. And as followers of Jesus Christ, let's get serious about living out a call to flood a world in darkness with the light of the gospel. Let's be the peacemakers amid the violence, taking the way of Jesus and the ways of the world. Let's walk along those who have been victimized and those who have reached compassion. Let's call out injustice and sin by showing people another way, the way of following Jesus. Let's get serious about being so contagious because of our hearts transformed by Christ that those who encounter us will desire the same. We must boldly speak against sin and injustice. But let us just as boldly proclaim the answer, the hope, the truth, the only solution for now and for all eternity, the one called Jesus. For if the church won't invite the world to the one who changes hearts and transforms lives, then who will? If we place our hope for change in anything above Jesus, may God forgive us. Holy Spirit, come. Holy God, change the hearts of your people. For God, may your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. In the hope of Christ, Bishop Mark Webb. To that I say, amen. It's there were moments when we were just talking about our own house and both of us were moved to tears because I can't anymore. I can't. Maybe you're like that today. And maybe it's not just the events that are happening in the world, it's events that happen in your own life, in your home. And you say, I can't anymore. Our hope is in Christ. In Christ alone. On this Memorial Day weekend, we remember our mentors, our founding fathers, our people who establish this church, this ministry, this community. The shoulders of those people that we stand on, we grieve today at their loss of life. We think back of our childhood friends, grandparents, perhaps who've gone on to worship the Lord in person. For those men and women who bravely and courageously gave us the freedoms that we enjoy, who lost, gave everything. Families lost, brothers and husbands, wives and sisters. We remember them as we remember them with we recall their faces. We know that we have the privilege of seeing them again in heaven, but boy, it hurts this weekend. So you pray with me today. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this life that we live in. We thank you for this beautiful world that you've created with the shining seas and the majestic mountains and birds singing in the majestic trees. God, it's a beautiful world. And we have some beautiful memories and beautiful things that have happened to us. But in the midst of all that, we live in a sinful and broken world where evil still lurks its head. People still do sinful and evil things. So God, we pray for disease or mental illness. We pray for the laws that make things like this too easy to happen. We pray, Lord God, for the children of Uvalde. We pray for those communities which has been rocked by this. We pray for the community of Buffalo and all the communities, Lord. There's just been constant shootings and violence and racism and hate-filled actions. God, we speak against that. We offer a better way. We cling, Lord, to the hope that is found in you. Because it can get discouraging, it can get really dark, God, but you are our hope. We hope in you alone. We pray, Lord God, for those who've lost loved ones, who now recall their names and faces, who love them forever. Lord, we honor their memory and appreciate their lives, their moments, the brief time they've spent being a part of us. They live with each of us now. And so this weekend we remember them. And we do pray, Lord, for those who are still recovering from sickness, from injuries. We thank you for those who you healed perfectly, like Beverly Lowenthal, and brought her to yourself. We pray for all those who have needs and requests. We bring them before you today, that there may be peace and may begin with us. We pray, oh God, these things and so many more unspoken in our hearts. We pray as you taught your own disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. The next reading is from chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God, the Father, through him.
Thank you.
series entitled Alter Ego. Kind of laying our ego aside at the altar, becoming not who we think we are, or who other people think we are, but who God says that we are. And we looked at a few of these in the past couple of weeks back there. We go through these, we talked a few weeks ago about our feelings of inadequacy. Right? Oftentimes we feel inadequate to do what God is calling us to do, but God has given us more than we think. God believes in us more than we think. It's more about God and less about us than we think. Last week we talked about giving up our need for control. We love to control people and situations. We want to do exactly what we want them to do. We want things to work out in a certain way. And so we need to lay that control aside and let God be the one who is certainly in control. Today we're talking about giving up our right to be offended. And that's a big one for me and for many, I know. In a few weeks we'll talk about forget about our longings for approval. We love to get approval of people. I have a sign in my office that says, "You didn't expect applause, did you?" And sometimes it's rough being a pastor, right? But some of I don't do it for the approval of people, I do it for the approval of God. So let's jump into this week's message. Laying down the right to be offended. We, at least for me, I'm often easily offended. Often by the most smallest and insignificant things, I get very easily offended. Maybe some of you can relate to that. I don't know what it is, but for me, it's just some people, man, maybe it's their tone of voice, they're kind of short with me, and you're like, who the heck do you think you are? Talking to me like that, right? Or maybe they're slow responding, right? You send them an email or a text, and they're really slow getting back to you. And you're thinking, well, wait a minute, who do you think you are? What's going on in your life that's so important you can't get back to me? I just texted you, it's been like 15 seconds. What are you doing? Come on, get back to me. Just a quick text, and you get easily offended by those things. Or they do something that's really, they do something that's really great, and they don't say, say they hurt you. Say they do something that hurts you. They mess up somehow. And they don't come quickly and say, I'm sorry. They don't apologize. Right? How does that make you feel? Or you do something for them, there's no acknowledgement. No thank you. No, hey, you're awesome. I appreciate it. Let me acknowledge you. You did something nice for them. And, boy, I've held the door for people. And thank you. You can say thank you. And help them. But we get easily offended by those things. I did that for them. They didn't do anything back for me. You just get really offended. Maybe they cut you off in traffic, right? Maybe any number of small things. It's like, hey, I don't know why they're acting that way. Or, can you believe the way they looked at me? Did you see that look that they gave me? Or, I can't believe they said this or they did that. I mean, we're so easily offended, right? I mean, come on, I'm talking about real stuff, even in the church world. It happens in church, too. Christians can be easily offended. But why is it? Why is it we're so easily offended? I think the reason is because we're living out of our egos, right? Our very insecure egos that want to be right, that want to win, and for us to be right, someone else has to be wrong, right? And for us to win, someone else has to lose. And so our egos are not only easily offended, but some people are actually looking to be offended. They're going to find things wrong everywhere they go. In fact, we have groups of people or friendships, their common basis is we're offended by the same things. We're in a group that doesn't like this situation or this person over here. And so we get together and we talk about we don't like them or we don't like that and we don't like everybody else. And we're offended because it's all about us. And we take everything personal. And what does Scripture have to say about this? Right? If it's a common thing that affects me, it affects you, right? We get offended by people. So what does Scripture say about this very common and sad condition? It's in our notes right there. I'll put it on the screen for you too. It's Proverbs 19:11. It's a verse that we should really commit to memory, that we should know this, right? It says, a person's wisdom yields patience. It is to one's glory to overlook an offense. Say that one with me, come on. A person's wisdom yields patience. It is to one's glory to overlook an offense. Now, we live in a world today that's quick to judge, quick to call a foul, quick to be offended and very slow to overlook an offense. Now, to overlook something doesn't mean you pretend it didn't happen, right? Because it did. But the Hebrew literally means, overlook means to just to pass over. You rise above an offense. It's our glory, it's your glory to overlook something, to catch a spiritual attitude and say, you know what, I'm not going to stay down here and be all offended, be all upset, ruin most of my day. I'm just going to rise above that. I'm just going to let that go. Yeah, that's not the way they looked at me or what they said. I'm just going to rise above that. I'm going to catch an attitude. Why let them ruin your day? Why let them hold you down? Have that more important thing to do than be weighed down by something that really truly doesn't matter. So you, right? It's one's glory to overlook an offense. And why do we really do that? It's because, again, we're living out of our egos, right? We're living out, not living out of the grace that God gave us through Christ, we're living out of our own egos. Right? I deserve a certain level of treatment, I deserve a certain level of respect, and this thing, if I don't get it, they don't say thank you, or they don't apologize, or they don't do this, they don't do that, then we get it all upset. Romans 12:3, your notes says this, for by the grace given me, Paul says, and Paul was extended all kinds of grace, right? For the grace given me, Paul says. Remember what Paul did when he was Saul? Same guy, what he did? He killed Christians. That's what he did. He killed Christians. And God, he persecuted them. And God sent this incredible, tremendous amount of grace. Did other people extend grace to Paul? Absolutely. Has God extended grace in your life? Who? Yes. Has God extended grace in your life? Everybody say yes. Yes, come on.
Yes.
Right? Do you hope other people extend grace to you? Yes. Right? We want that. And Paul says, for by the grace given me, God has given me so much grace, people have given me so much grace, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourselves more highly than you ought. Don't let it be about your ego. But rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the measure of faith God has given you. For by the grace God has given me, I will not think more highly of myself than I ought. And when I don't lift myself up, I won't be so easily offended. Right? Here's 3 points I want to make today. You can write these down in your notes. But 3 points of application. Here's the first one. Because of Christ's grace given to me, I'll give others the benefit of the doubt. I'll give others the benefit of the doubt. Ephesians 4:2, you know, it says this. Always be humble. It's not about you, it's not about me. Be humble. Always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Because of God's grace given to me, I'm going to give others the benefit of the doubt. And isn't it interesting, though, that we don't give others the benefit of the doubt? What we do is we judge others on their actions, but we judge ourselves on our intentions. We judge others on their actions. We judge ourselves by our intentions. Well, they did this, or they didn't do that. Well, I intended to. I meant to. Well, maybe they did too. But we're judging on our actions, we judge ourselves on our own intentions. Well, I intended to. You should give me the benefit of the doubt, right? Because I intended to say I'm sorry. I intended to call, I intended to. You should give me the benefit of the doubt, but I'm not going to give you the benefit of the doubt. But we should, right? I mean, let's be honest. Because of the grace given to me, it's very simple to give others the benefit of the doubt. Maybe when that cashier is short with you, maybe they're having a really terrible day. Maybe the teenager is making some incredibly destructive decisions and they're preoccupied. And they didn't notice you. But you're important and they should have noticed you and said, hi to you, but they didn't because they were preoccupied. Maybe they just heard something from the doctor that's really bad news. Maybe they're running behind and they cut you off in traffic. That person's an idiot. That person's a jerk. They cut me off. But maybe, just maybe, It's not about you. Maybe they're preoccupied because they just got some devastating news and they're cutting you off. It has nothing to do with you. They just made a bad decision. Maybe their bad mood is not about you at all. And so because of the grace extended to me, I want to give other people benefit of the doubt. I have no idea what's going on. I just can't assume those things. As a Christian, here's what we should have. We should have thick skin and soft hearts. Many people have hard hearts and a little soft skin, right? They're easily offended by everything, but they got a hard heart. As Christians, we should have like rhinoceros skin, really thick skin, right? But we should have really, really soft hearts. I want that preaching to you today. I found in all my years of counseling people, the last 23 years, this to be true. Hurt people hurt people. Right? When people are hurting, they're defensive. They're wounded. If you think of them as wounded, it helps you have compassion and grace on them rather than being angry, rather than being offended by them. Because they're hurt. And hurt people hurt people. You get a wounded animal that's cornered, they're going to be defensive, right? Because it's wounded. It's going to attack and reach out and try to hurt you. And that's what wounded people do. But if I see someone as wounded, it helps me to have compassion on them. Because they're hurting. I wonder what they're going through that they would act in this way. I wonder how I can pray for them. So rather than be offended by them, I have compassion for them because the grace God has given to me, I give others the benefit of the doubt. Well, if we did this, folks, start changing the world one person at a time. Here's the second thing, because you're taking notes. Here's number two. Because of the grace given to me in Christ, I will not label other people. I will not label others. Can you imagine if God labeled us? If God took an isolated event from the different seasons of our life, and then he ascribed that label to us. Listen, when I was younger, I used to cheat, used to lie. When I cheated someone in school, I would lie to my parents, or a lot of my friends. So what if God took that isolated event in a different season of my life, and he labeled me that now? You know, new pastor, Brad Foothill. He's a cheat, he's a liar. No, I'm not. You blanket statement that, and we do that all the time. I told you before about a kid who stole my girlfriend like back in 10th grade. I still didn't like him. So the guy's an idiot. He's not an idiot. He was a 15-year-old kid who decided he liked my girlfriend better than his. We take isolated events. Something that happened, a chance encounter, ran into someone, that person is a jerk, an idiot, a liar, they're a cheat, they're whatever. And we label them for the rest of their lives with that label. He's nothing but a jerk, right? She's a you know what, a Satan church, right? But, you know, they're a control freak, they're this, they're that, and people label them permanently over a temporary moment in time. What did Jesus say about this? Luke 36, 37. He says, be merciful, right? God has been merciful to us. Be merciful just as your Father is merciful. Do not judge and you will not be judged. Do not condemn and you will not be condemned. Forgive and you will be forgiven because of God's grace. I'm not going to label other people. But man, we do it. And we do it all of the time. Some of you, your label is maybe more dangerous than that. You've labeled your spouse. She's this, or he's that, and you're discounting what God can do in your spouse's life. Or you've labeled a child, you've labeled someone else, and you say, you're going to be this, you're never going to amount to this, you're such a, and we're discounting what God can do in their lives. We're easily offended. We're looking for reasons to be offended instead of giving people the benefit of the doubt. Instead of choosing not to label people. That cashier was so rude, that waiter never came back for my drinks, and we have no idea. Give them the benefit of the doubt. And don't label people. Because labels, it's like labeling people ain't cool. There you go. I can't say better than a stranger. It ain't cool. Don't do it. It needs to stop. Number three is this. And this is a Because of the grace Christ has given me, I will forgive as I've been forgiven. I will forgive others as Christ has forgiven me. Here's what Scripture says, Colossians 3:13. Make allowance for each other's faults. Don't miss this part. And forgive anyone who offends you. So the Bible says, forgive anyone who offends you. Let's just pause for a moment, because that's a pretty firm statement. Forgive anyone who offends you. Remember what the Lord did. The Lord forgave you, and so you must do what? You must forgive others. And you're thinking, okay, Pastor Brad, I get that. Someone cuts me off in traffic, I'm supposed to forgive them. You know, someone forgets to say thank you, I'll overlook that. I'll catch in spiritual attitude and altitude, and I'll just get above that. Someone cuts in front of me in line, I'll get over that. But what about? What do we do when something really, really big, you know, happens? Some massive offense. Maybe they abused you, they hurt someone that you love, or they lied about you, or it cost you something, or their spouse cheats on you. What about those big things? Right? Pastor, you're not saying I have to forgive that, right? It's just the little stuff, right? I mean, you're not telling me I can overlook the small things. But big things, man, I'm justified in being angry, right? I mean, I'm justified in carrying that bitterness. I mean, God understands that I want revenge for the big things, right? I don't have to forgive those, right, Pastor? There's no way you're telling me that, right? Well, Jesus said this, and this to me is incredibly sobering. Matthew 6, 14 and 15 says, for if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will forgive you also. But if you do not forgive men and women their sins, what does Jesus say? Your Father will not forgive your sins. That's sobering to me. That's frightening to me. If you do not forgive others when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will not forgive you. Right, so if I haven't forgiven someone for something, God doesn't forgive me? What if I'm not forgiven? That's scary to me. I mean, I'll be honest with you, that verse has haunted me more than it's about any other verse in Scripture. Because how do you forgive, like, abuse, right? How do you forgive a betrayal? We said vows, we said yes at the altar and then no in the marriage. What about that? How do you forgive someone who is in a position of authority and abuses their authority and hurts innocent people? How do you forgive that? How do you forgive something that seems totally unforgivable? How can we do that? Ephesians 4:32 shows us how. It tells us to be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you. We are to forgive because we have been forgiven. It's to God's glory that we overlook an offense. And so we forgive as we've been forgiven. And what's so great about this is when you think about how God forgives, right? If you go back in the Old Testament, right, they had an altar, and how would people be forgiven? The people would take an innocent animal, and they would sacrifice an animal at the altar, right? And the shedding of the animal's blood, there would be forgiveness. It's a story about the Passover, right? They would actually take the blood from the sacrificed lamb, and they would dip it in a sponge, they would move it all around the door casings of their home, all sides of the doorpost. And then the blood at the top of the doorpost began to drip down to the bottom. And you see in the Old Testament the foreshadowing of the cross where Jesus Christ shed his innocent blood. For what? For a cross. Because of the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, the perfect sacrifice, shed his blood to cover our sins. Now God passes over us, right? He forgives us in real time. Not because of what we've done, but because of what Christ did, Jesus dying for our sins. So when we understand this, when we understand how we've been forgiven, when we acknowledge that hurt people hurt people, we should also remember that forgiven people forgive people. Because we have been forgiven, we can forgive. It's not about us. It's all about Him. I don't have a right to be offended. I'm not justified in my anger. It's not all about me winning. But because of what Christ did for me, I'm honored to give people the benefit of the doubt. I'm honored to not label people, because I don't want to be labeled myself. And it's because of what Christ did for me. I will forgive others because I have been forgiven. Doesn't mean it's easy. It means it's right. And the more you experience the grace of Jesus Christ, the more you forgive in real time. It's to one's glory to overlook an offense. It's to one's glory, to your glory, to overlook that. I can stand on here and be offended by every single thing. But God said, just let that go. And that's not all about you. Forgive them as you have been forgiven. So there's two big questions, and I'll close this thing up. I wonder how many of you are just like me, that oftentimes you get easily offended. Right? You're easily offended, you're quick to be offended. Everything is, believe me, I have moments of self-doubt, like I always say, everybody hates me. You don't want to be that way. But you realize maybe sometimes you are. So we want to just lay that part of our ego down and be who God says we are. I wonder maybe someone's wronged you. Someone's hurt you really bad, betrayed you, let you down, and you're holding that grudge. You've been offended, and you just can't let it go. If you're real honest, you're going to say, I don't want to let it go. I mean, I know I should, but I can't. I don't want to. God, help me to want to. To lay it out. I've been carrying that burden on for so long. Got to let it go. And when you do, you're going to realize you're set a prisoner free. And when that, you realize that prisoner is actually you. Let's pray together. God, I lift up these people to you today. And God, because of our egos, our collective egos, it's so easy to jump to an offense, to assume an offense, to even look for one. But today, God, help us to live in the grace so much that for your glory, we could just pass over those things, just forgive in real time. God, I pray that you would give us thick skin and a soft heart for people, to see them as you see them, and to love them, God, as you love them. God, for those today who are carrying a deep offense, a significant wound, maybe they've taken on the offense of another, God, I pray right now you supernaturally would give us the ability to forgive as we have been forgiven. God, even though we don't want to, we don't believe that we can, God, because of your grace and through your power, we can. God, set us free, help us to let those things go. God, we acknowledge that trust will still take time to build up, and that we may not want to run right back to the place where we feel vulnerable, but God, help us to do in this moment, in your presence, what is right, and to release others as you have released us from our own sin. Father, we pray that your Spirit would do something that we're incapable of doing ourselves. You would bring healing in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Before we sing this closing hymn, I know we have Sharon Biesdorf who's going to give us a special announcement today from the SPRC committee, so stay tuned for that, and then we'll sing our closing hymn, Help Us Accept Each Other, right afterwards. So bring on Sharon, you're on there here.
Selfishly without pay from the time of COVID restrictions to now. You've been very vital in moving this church forward to reaching our goal of a new location for worship and ministry in the community. We're so close to being in the new building, and we thank you. We all have different talents and gifts to be shared together for the glory of God, and in togetherness, greater good can come. Pastor Brad has communicated with Vivian that we really don't want to lose her. The entire SBRC committee appreciates all of her contributions and would love to have her stay as choir director. We'd love to have you reconsider and stay, but that being said, we respect your choice to move forward to new endeavors. We wish the congregation to know that we're moving forward with ideas and solutions to continue our music program with the assistance of Melvin Koga, our organist. If you have any questions, you can speak to Pastor Brad, Cindy Van Allen, or any member of the SPRC committee. So would the members of the committee please stand? So those are all the people that you can speak to if you have questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon, for that. Can we stand in closing song, Help Us Accept Each Other? Let's sing together. Thanks.